for them. The priest that was just recently murdered. Pray for him. God is merciful. He is merciful. And if you don't pray for them, shame on you. There will be a day. I'm telling you, there will be a day that you want someone to pray for you, and you're going to be sitting right there, and there's nobody praying for you. And I can tell you about our priest. Only a priest can hear your confession and give you absolution. Only a priest. Only a priest can change that body and that blood, that bread and that wine, into the body and blood of Christ. No matter what a priest does, their hands are so holy. You don't understand it, but I saw what happens when a priest is ordained. What is shown to me from heaven that comes down unto them. And I love my priest. I pray for priests. I pray constantly for them. Because when I'm dying, I hope he's there to hear my confession and give me absolution. And let me tell you what. If you don't think that that's not the body and blood of our Lord on this altar, think again. Think again. It is him. It's not bread and it's not wine. And I often tell people, adoration, when the Blessed Sacrament is out, you kneel before him. If you cannot kneel, then sit and bow your head. You kneel. He will make you kneel eventually. I can't, if he wants me to kneel and pray, I can't pray with any person and stand. Period. I'm not allowed to. When I start, I've tried it a couple of times, and I get this on my shoulder, and I go down on my knees, and very quietly I hear his voice, our Lord's voice. And he tells me, kneel, child. It's a sign of humility and obedience to him. And when I kneel, he kneels with me. He's praying with me. When I'm praying for these people, Christ is right there. The Blessed Mother reminded me of the rosary again. She told me and showed me all the time. She heard my prayers, every prayer I'd ever uttered to her. I never knew Christ until my death experience. Why? He was just the guy on the cross. I always had a special love for the Blessed Mother from the time I was real little. I made a mistake. I've always felt like I wished I hadn't asked him this question. But I asked him when they scourged him, was it very bad? Because you see, I see the crucifixes with a little bit of blood on the hands, feet, and side and head. And I thought, was it really bad, Lord? Well, he gave me a flash what he looked like on the cross. And this little picture is what he looked like. And then he proceeded to tell me, about his beating. He said that they used bones and stones and shells. Some were sharpened and some were curved. And when they would hit him and they would yank, they would rip his skin and it would cut down even to the tendons in there and the muscle. That even the soles of his feet were ripped apart and that there was no place in his body that wasn't ripped and torn. What you all don't know is that Jesus had no covering, nothing on him. Nothing on him when they beat him. And then they put the robe, his robe back on him, and then they march him up to the hill where they're going to nail him to the cross. And he said the pain was so excruciating. I'm
was so horrible, y'all. You, we think we can't suffer. You know, we just go and say, oh, I want a pill for this or that. I can't stand the suffering. You can be surprised at what you can suffer. And when they started to nail his hand, first hand to the cross, his mother asked Almighty God to please cover him so that he wouldn't be humiliated anymore. And God let her cover him. The cloth you see around him was the cloth that she had wrapped him in as a baby. And that's what was on him. And all of this he suffered for you and I. Out of love. Love. And it wasn't the nails that held him on that cross either. It was his love for each one of us. Because he knew when they hung him up there, he could have said any time, Father, I see that what they're going to do. I don't want to hang up here. I know how bad people are going to be. But he didn't. He stayed there out of love for you and I. Out of love for you and I. You just never know that kind of love. I thought I knew what love was with my children because I love my children so much. But God showed me that his love is even more than the love that I had for my children. Then he said that he was going to show me things and some things that I would never forget. And I wished he hadn't, and these were some of the things that I tried to forget, besides trying to forget about hell. And he showed me the abortions, and he showed me babies being destroyed up to the time of their birth, and I saw billions of babies, and I couldn't understand it. I kept asking him, well, why? What are you showing me, Lord? And he said, this is what mankind thinks of my gift of life, my Father's gift of life. And, you know, it was 3 years before the Wade verse Roe that I had my death experience. And it wasn't until that Wade verse Roe came out that I understood. And I started trying to really push against abortion. And I got doors slammed in my face. I had people tell me I was crazy. I had women tell me it was their own business. It was their bodies. They could do what they wanted to. I went nose to nose with doctors. And would not give up. I kept telling them it was wrong, and I said, you all will kill until the child is ready to be born. It's wrong. That is a gift of life. And I was told the woman's right to her own body. That's what I was given. I had wrote letters to congressmen and senators up in Washington asking them to repeal that law. And I got letters back, and I wish to this day I had them. When we moved from Houston to Louisiana, I had friends helping me pack. And they accidentally threw away the letters that I'd gotten back. But this was what the letters would say. Dear Mrs. Abrahams, I know that you are concerned about this abortion law, Wade versus Roe. But you have to understand the women of America have spoken. They want the abortions and they have the right to abortions. And I'd write back, dear Senator, since when does that woman own her body? God made it. God created it. Only God can take it. I'm sorry, you're wrong. And I'd get another letter back. And then after that, they would just stop answering. I guess they went and filed 13 or whatever. I had a stack, y'all, like this, of letters. I had been fighting abortion for 33 years because I started before Wade versus Roe. I know that's why people thought I was crazy, because I was talking about abortion way back then. You have to speak out, people. You can't let the neighbor next door do it. It takes